Let us pray. Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, humble as we know how.
Yes.
Father, we come asking your forgiveness, Father, for all our sins and for all our evil thoughts.
Yes.
We're asking your Father this morning to create in us a clean heart, Father, and renew the right spirit in us, Lord. We ask your blessing on the sick all over the country and all over the land. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. Go with us now throughout the day. Lead us, guide us, and direct us, Father, as you would have us to do and say this morning, Father. We thank you now. Bless us and keep us, Father. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Will you say thank you, Jesus?
Thank you, Jesus.
Will you say thank you, Jesus?
Thank you, Jesus.
You can say it with your horns. Amen. I heard it. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. The message says, he thought we were worth saving. Have you ever been to the junkyard? Probably you didn't, but your grandmother probably did.
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord. So why are you going to the junkyard? Because sometimes you find those things that have been thrown away that'll be of good use. Go to the junkyard. Tell me they call it. They call it something else now. Landfill. Hallelujah.
You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Hold on. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was a dinosaur. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know.
Judges. Judges chapter 8.
Hallelujah.
Verses 4 through 12. Judges chapter 8, verses 4 through 12. Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, for your goodness and your mercy, Lord, we thank you. For this day, Lord, that you have made, we thank you. Lord, for being the center of our joy, we thank you. And Lord, when people fail us, Lord, we thank you for still being the center of our joy. We thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice that you gave us in your son, Jesus Christ, some 2,000 years ago. And Lord, we don't come here on church on Sunday for form and fashion. But Lord, we come here with a new praise and a new worship. Understanding, Lord, that morning by morning that you give us a new mercy. So we thank you right now, God. We ask, Lord, that you come down on this service. Continue, Lord, to lead us and to guide us. It's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Judges chapter 8, verses 4 through 12. When Gideon came to the Jordan, he and the 300 men who were with him crossed over, exhausted but still in pursuit. Then he said to the men of Succoth, please give loads of the bread to the people who follow me, for they are exhausted. And I am pursuing Zeba and Zalumma, kings of Midian. And the leaders of Succoth said, are the hands of Zeba and Zalumma now in your hand, that we should give bread to your army? So Gideon said, for this cause, when the Lord has delivered Zeba and Zalumma into my hand, then I will tear your flesh with the thorns of the wilderness and with briars. Then he went up there to Peniel and spoke to them in the same way. And the men of Peniel answered him as the men of Succoth had answered. So he also spoke to the men of Peniel, saying, when I come back in peace, I will tear down this tower. Now Zeba and Zalumma were at Karkor, and their armies with them, about 15,000, all who were left of all the army of the people of the east, for 120,000 men who drew the sword had fallen. Then Gideon went up by the road of those who dwell in the tents of east of Nobah and Jobah, and he attacked the army while the camp felt secure. When Zeba and Zalumma fled, he pursued them, and he took the two kings of Midian, Zeba and Zalumma, and routed the whole army. Let's hear verse 4 again. When Gideon came to the Jordan, he and the 300 men who were with him crossed over, exhausted, but still in pursuit. I want to use for a subject, tired but not done. Tired but not done. Most of us can look back at our high school and our college years, and we can all remember that one hard class that we had to go through. Because in order to get that diploma, and in order to get that degree, there was always one class that people tell you not to wait until your last year, because if by chance you don't pass it, you won't graduate. And for me as a student at Fairfield State, that class was Accounting 202, also known as Intermediate Accounting. And the objective of the class were to understand and to analyze a variety of accounting topics, including corporate income taxes, methods for cost accounting, and post-retirement benefits. And for me, this class was as hard as the course description sounds, because the professor was a mastermind in accounting, but he was far from a good teacher. And he spoke with an African accent that was hard for us to understand. And when he came to class, he would grab some chalk and start writing on the chalkboard. And he would face the chalkboard for 50 minutes every class. And he never stopped to take any questions. He never had any office hours. And it was hard to take notes because none of us understood what he was saying. And this class was so hard that when we got to the final exam, that there were only 3 questions on the exam. And let me tell you how you know that you're in trouble. Because when you read through all of the questions and you don't know where to start on any of them, you know it's going to be a long day. And the test was so hard that we couldn't even cheat. Because after about 5 minutes, everybody had the same confused look on their face. So I started doing what I knew how to do. And I started writing down all the accounting formulas that I could remember. Then I wrote down some formulas that didn't have anything with to do with accounting. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Pi times R squared. And y'all, I'm just writing down whatever I can, praying that some extra credit is gonna kick in somewhere. And that was the last exam that I had to take that semester. So when my grades came in the mail, and even though my name was on the envelope, my dad opened it up because he said that he was paying for it. And he called me into the kitchen and he asked me about the grade that I had in intermediate accounting because I had gotten a C minus. And y'all, I was thankful to God because I was certain that I had failed. But I survived that class by a gift called a curve. And if you don't know what a curve is, just let me tell you that that's God at work. And my dad said, well, you must be happy that you passed intermediate accounting. And I told him not really, because when I go back in the spring, that I have to take accounting 303, intermediate accounting 2. And my dad began to understand what I went through then, that kills your joy. When you come to the end of something and it's taking everything that you gotten to get there, only for you to look up and see that you have more to do. Because it's a sad thing to be tired at the end and know that you have to start all over again. And y'all, that's what we find Gideon in this morning, in this 8th chapter. And hopefully we remember Gideon from a few weeks ago, because the Midianites have taken over Israel. And for the Lord to deliver the Israel from the Midianites, he decides to raise up a brother by the name of Gideon. But now we need to know that the Lord doesn't find Gideon in the gym. Gideon is not in the parking lot. Gideon is not on Facebook. But Gideon is thrashing wheat in the wine press. Now I know that y'all are holy and sanctified, so y'all didn't catch that. Because Gideon is at the liquor store. And the Lord shows up and he tells Gideon that you're going to deliver my people from the hands of the Midianites. And let me tell y'all real quick, that we should never judge somebody's future potential by their current position. Because the Lord has a way of moving people from some needy and some dirty places to be great and powerful in his kingdom and to do things that you never thought anybody like that could do. So Gideon decides to accept the Lord's call and he gathers 32,000 men to go to battle. But God shows up in chapter 7 and he says, nah, that's too many because you can't win with that many people. So the Lord begins to alter some associations and to change some connections. And he leaves Gideon with 300 men to go to battle. Yeah. And the Bible says that with 300 men by his side, that Gideon defeats the Midianites, whose numbers were in the thousands. So in chapter 7, they defeat the Midianites. Only for us to find out in chapter 8 that the battle ain't over. Because in chapter 8, Gideon, these same 300 men, are now at the border of Israel at the Jordan River. And the Jordan River symbolizes the boundary of Israel and the end of the promised land. And verse 4 tells us, when Gideon came to the Jordan, he and the 300 men who were with him crossed over. So y'all, they're about to cross over into a new land. They're about to cross over into a new season. They're about to cross over into a new period. So they come to the end of one season, and they're about to cross over into a new season. And the testimony of the word of God is that this mighty man of valor with his 300 soldiers, when they get to the border and they're ready to cross over, the Bible says that they're exhausted. And y'all, that word exhausted means that they were fatigued. It means that they were worn out. It means they were depleted. It means that they were running on empty. So they come to the place of crossover only to be tired and worn out. Because this battle and this journey and these struggles that I've been through have worn me out. And all of us can reach a place of crossing over into a new season and into a land and a new period, only to get to that place on June 27th and realize that I'm tired and I'm worn out. Because I'm tired of sickness and of death. I'm tired of COVID and of masks. I'm tired of hearing about black people getting killed by police. I'm tired of symbolism that comes with no reparations. I'm tired of voter suppression and voter intimidation. I'm tired of racism and discrimination. I'm tired of mass shootings and mass murders. And I know that y'all are holier than I am. And you want me to be holy and more sanctified than you are. And you want me to be above all that. But y'all, I'm tired. And somebody has come to church today, and you're personally tired. Because you're tired of going back and forth to the doctor. You're tired of having to go to the school and get the teachers right. You're tired of crazy coworkers and demonic supervisors. You're tired of struggling to make ends meet. And as a matter of fact, you tired of church. because church folk done got on your last good nerve. And I'm sick and tired because it's been that kind of season. And is there anybody here this morning who can admit halfway through the year that I'm tired? Tell somebody I'm tired of you. And verse 4 tells that Gideon is exhausted, but still in pursuit. So I'm tired, but I'm not done yet. And there's some things that God wants from me as I cross over into this new season. So let me give us three things that the Lord says to the people who are tired but not done yet. Because number one, God needs us to finish our past projects. Tell somebody, finish what you started. So now we need to know why Gideon is crossing over. Because he's crossing over because he's chasing two Midianite kings by the name of Zeba and Zalmunna. And Zeba and Zalmunna on the battlefield, but they escaped and they went to a place called Karkor. So even though the battle when the battlefield is over, your assignment is not done until you handle in chapter 8 what escaped you in chapter 7. So there's some things that you thought you had handled, but it hadn't been dealt with yet. And you cannot move forward until you finish what you started. And some of us have some Zebas and Zalmunnas on our agenda. Because there's some things that we began and that we started. And the Lord is saying that your new season can't begin until you cross that T and dot that I and handle that business and tie up those loose ends and deal with the stuff that you thought was in your past. And y'all, what that tells us is there's some things that we have to deal with in order to move forward. And y'all, that's a real word this morning, because most of us have been deceived by the devil because we allow things to linger from our past, not understanding that it's going to affect the peace of our future. And the Lord says there's some things we have to handle. So before you leave church this morning, you got some business that you need to handle. You have some conversations you need to have. You have some text messages you need to send. You have some paperwork you need to file. You have some relationships you need to repair. You have some apologies you need to offer. There's some things that you need to deal with before you cross over. But y'all, not only do we have to deal with our past stuff, because the Lord says that I want you to separate from problematic people. And y'all, there's some good gospel right there. Because you came to church for the Lord to tell you to let them go. Because verse 5 tells us that Gideon said to the men of Socoh, please give loaves of bread to the people who follow me, for they are exhausted. And I'm pursuing Zeba and Zalmunna, kings of Midian. And verse 6 tells us that they refused to help Gideon. Now, y'all, what got me is that Socoh is in the land that is owned by the tribe of Gad. And Peniel is the place where Jacob wrestled with an angel. So we can assume that everybody in Socoh and everybody in Peniel are Israelites. And they are Gideon's own people. So they are the people that look like him. They are the people that worship with him. They are the people that serve the same God. And Gideon recognized that the same people that he thought would help me are the same people that refused to help me when I needed them the most. And let me tell y'all why half of y'all are quiet. Because most of us are surprised when we get rejected. Because somebody sitting around you right now is dysfunctional when they dislike. Somebody that you live with can't handle being turned down. So whenever people reject us and refuse us, we can't operate and we can't function. But y'all, what I like about Gideon is that when his own people turn him down, he doesn't stop doing what God has called him to do. And Gideon can still operate and still function. Because in chapter 7, when he showed up with 32,000 people, God taught him a valuable lesson. Because you don't need all of them to do what I called you to do. Because you don't need Lottie, Dottie, and everybody. But all you need is the assurance that God is with you. And you don't need anybody else. And y'all, the biggest lesson that the Lord has been trying to teach us through this quarantine and through this isolation is that everybody that you want, that you don't need. And everybody that you love is not ordained to be in your life. And some people are problematic to your destiny. Ask somebody, have you learned your lesson? So watch the text, y'all. Because when Gideon's own people turn him down, he doesn't beg them to change their mind. Because we have to reach a place with our walks with God. Well, you understand that you don't have to beg nobody to help you do nothing. And if they don't want to help, if they don't want to stand with you, if they don't want to support you, then let them go. So watch what Gideon does in verse 7 when he sees that they won't help him. Because not only does he not beg them, but he threatens them. So that's cool, because y'all ain't got to help me. But when I come back through here, and the Lord is giving me the victory, you're going to understand I didn't need your bread. I didn't need your support. I didn't need your money. I didn't need your friendship, because I have a God who is able to make a way out of no way. And has anybody had to learn the hard way this year that I don't need what you have, because God is able to make a way? Tell somebody God is taking care of me. So finish your past projects. Get away from problematic people. And as you cross over, I want you to remember my previous provisions. Because one thing that none of us should ever forget are the ways that God has made. One thing that none of us should ever forget are the doors that God has opened. And the prayers that God has answered. And the mountains that God has moved. And the healing that God has given. And the provisions that God has sent. And we should never forget how God has good God has been. I'm coming to my close, y'all. But watch how they move. Because they go across the Jordan into Succoth, and they hang out in Peniel. So they go across the Jordan into Succoth, and they hang out in Peniel. And y'all, the Jordan, it is the river that the Lord opened with his miraculous hand. Succoth is the land that God gave to Gad, and Gad didn't have to fight for it, but the Lord just gave it to him. Peniel is the place where Jacob wrestled with God, and he should have died right there. But the grace and mercy of God kept them. Yeah. So y'all, when they cross the Jordan, they're crossing over to a place of miracles. When they get to Succoth, they're in a place where grace of God gives you that you don't deserve. When they get to Peniel, they remember God's merciful hand who doesn't kill us when we deserve to die. And that's what all of us need to do when we're tired but not done. You need to go back to God's files, a file of God's miracles. And is there anybody here this morning who knows that God has worked some miracles in your life? Well, if you don't have a miracle file, I know you have a grace file of some things that God has blessed you with that you know you didn't deserve. And if you don't have a grace file, you sure enough have a mercy file of how God has forgiven you, how God has protected you, and how God has shielded you. Is there anybody here this morning who can say, I have a miracle file? I have a grace file. I have a mercy file. And when I think of the miracle he's made, when I think of the grace that he's given, when I think of the mercy of God, that I will bless God right here and right now, that I will bless God at all times. Is there anybody here this morning who can bless him right here? Is there anybody here who can bless him right now? So bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, because he's been that good. He's been that great. He's been that gracious. God bless you all.